So this is second lecture. Let me just remind you that we started yesterday looking at finite field-based cryptography, and so far we have not seen any cryptography. So we're still in the codes part, which I spent most of the time yesterday doing. And then I realized I built these slides and course on the assumption that you would have been trained to basic cryptography before this lecture, these lectures. And then I realized that some of you may not. So I decided to, again, open a small parenthesis just to make sure that I say a few words about cryptography before I actually give you some crypto systems. So most of the systems I'm going to show you are of the so-called flavor public key encryption. And I'm sure you've all heard a little bit about them, but let me point out at least a few things. In a public key encryption scheme, we have the plain text messages, which is the messages before they get encrypted, and they become encrypted as ciphertext through an encryption process which uses a key, K-E-E as an encryption, and in public key cryptography, the decryption key is different from the encryption key and is kept private. So it's a public key system because the encryption key is made available to everybody and the decryption key is restricted to whoever is doing the decryption. Now, for security reasons, and in order to achieve strong notions of security for crypto systems, we usually randomize the encryption process. So the encryption not only receives a message to be encrypted, but also some random bits that are put into the process of encryption. And therefore, typically, encryption is not a one-to-one mapping. It's mapping to many possible values, which all get decrypted back to the original plaintext. And pretty much all the systems we're going to see are of this flavor. They come with some randomization inherently in their structure, which is actually a good ingredient from a security point of view. Now, the reason why public key cryptography is so popular is because it has the great advantage that if I have someone, Bob, who's never met Alice, but has access to Alice's public key, he can use that public key to encrypt messages for Alice in such a way that she, using her private key, the decryption key, can decrypt. And so Bob does the encryption process from some message to the encrypted unreadable message, and the decryption process yields back the original message that Bob intended to send. Now, in some of what I'm going to say today in particular, I'm not just going to talk about encryption schemes. I'm also going to talk about signature schemes, digital signature schemes. And this is the second most popular topic in cryptography. Digital signatures are used to authenticate information. So in the realm of digital signature schemes, you have messages and you wish to add something to the message so that the message together with its tag part can be verified to be authentic to the person who created it. And so in particular, there will be in such a process the messages, the tags, an authentication key for the authentication function, and a verification key for a verification function, so that once the person who knows the secret authentication key happens a tag with the message, it can be verified by everybody using the public key as being genuine from the person who's doing the signatures. So for Alice, who presumably has never met Bob before, she's able to receive a message from Bob and validate that this message actually came from him. For this, she needs Bob's public key in dark red, and Bob using his private key in light red, he can authenticate a message, "Will you marry me?" get the corresponding tag in blue, send both of them together, and Alice can verify that if she recompute the verification process, if she computes the verification process using the darker red key on this message with this tag, she will detect that it's valid. And on what we're trying to detect here is if someone tries to sneak in and try to modify the message as it's ongoing, we expect that the verification process by Alice will fail. Okay, so this is the end of my parenthesis about cryptography. I will be talking about both of these today, and in particular, I'm going to have a few words about signature schemes. Now, let me go back to codes and how we can use them to develop a cryptographic system for encryption. So I'm now defining the code equivalence problem. If you're given two linear codes, C and C prime, of same length, same dimension, and same minimum distance, we say that these two codes are permutation equivalent of each other if there exists a non-singular matrix S, k by k, and if there exists a permutation matrix P, a permutation matrix is a matrix such that each line and each column, each row and each column contains a single one. And so on. And so we say that the two codes C and C prime are permutation equivalent, but I'm going to drop the word permutation from here on, if they're generating matrices G for C and G prime for C prime are related with such a pair of matrices. Essentially, what you can see here is that the product of S with G by a non-singular matrix is just changing basis. So if you have some basis G, SG is some other basis of the same subspace, of the same code, essentially. And then applying this permutation matrix P moves around the columns of the matrix. Now, what is remarkable about equivalent codes is that the code words of C and C prime don't, of course, are typically different. They look very different, but all the weights of the words are preserved. So if I start with a word of weight 7 and I move the columns around, well, I still have a word of weight 7. So the weights are preserved, but the codes look different. Now, code equivalence is very convenient because if I have two equivalent codes, if I have a C prime, which is equivalent to a code C, and if I know an error correction procedure for C, then it's very easy to use that error correction procedure for C prime as well. So if I have core, this error correction procedure that will fix errors up to D minus 1 over 2, then I very simply can use the combination of applying the permutation, applying the inverse permutation to the word I'm trying to correct, move from C prime into C, correct the word as in C, and then go back to C prime by repermuting the coordinates. Okay, so it's very easy. If I can correct one, that I can also correct the other. So these processes are completely related just by using the permutation. Okay, so then the resulting correction procedure, cor prime, is as efficient as the original one, except for these multiplication by these matrices, which is very low cost. Now, we're going to use this fact in our construction of a cryptographic scheme. We're essentially going to build a system where there's a private representation of the code in which we know an efficient correction algorithm, and we're going to transform that into a public version of that code such that it's going to be difficult for everybody else to figure out how to do error correction. So the person who introduced this is Robert McLeese, who in 1978, so this is way back, introduced his public key crypto system. McLeese's public key crypto system uses GOPA codes. I gave you a few words last time about what GOPA codes are, but what is important about GOPA codes is that there are very many of them, and if you pick one at random, it already has a fair amount of randomness involved in it. And to some extent, it already has a lot of possibility of looking completely random. Of course, it's not, because GOPA codes has the feature that we have an efficient decoding and error correcting procedure with it. So what McLeese suggested is start with some GOPA code for a certain size and a certain dimension and a certain minimum distance. Choose a non-singular matrix S at random. Choose a permutation matrix P at random. And the private key of the crypto system is going to be those parameters G, S, and P, whereas the public key of the system is going to be G prime, which is the generating matrix of an equivalent code as GP. Now, if you wish to encrypt a message string of n bits, you use the public matrix G prime. You compute MG prime, which is a code word in C prime associated with M. Okay, so if you remember from yesterday, when I multiply a vector times a generating matrix, it yields a code word. And then I will add to it some error vector of the weight, the maximum weight that the code is able to correct. So I pick at random some error vector of the appropriate weight, and I add that to the code word. Now the result is a word which is not too far from a code word, but which is sufficiently far from a code word that unless you know the exact structure of G, which gives you an efficient error correcting procedure, unless you know that, there doesn't seem to be any efficient way of recovering M from the public information, which is the ciphertext W, together with G prime. So the public information of the scheme is G prime which is SGP, and a word W, which is MG prime plus some error E. Now, the assumption that we make is that given G prime and W, recovering the code word which is nearest to W is a difficult problem. Now, if we knew S and P, if we knew the original basis of the code G, it would be easy because GAPO codes can be decoded by the Burlakoff-Welsh algorithm that I mentioned yesterday. And therefore, it's easy for the person who knows the private key to solve this equation. But for someone who doesn't know the specific representation involving S and P, for those who don't know G, it appears to be a difficult problem to fix the errors and recover the nearest code word. Now, if I get the nearest code word, I can use I can use the decoding algorithm of the code to recover what M was. So if I know what C prime is, then I can find M because M is just the decoding of C prime. Now let me emphasize that I'm using two words and I don't want you to be misled by these two words. When I use the word decoding, I mean going back from a code word to the information word that's related to it. And when I say error correcting, then I mean start from something which is not a code word and get to the nearest code word. Okay, so to recover M from C prime, you need the decoding algorithm, and that's completely public. If you know G prime, you can do decoding. You can find the information word from the code word. Now, what is remarkable is that after all these years, since 1978, when this was introduced, this crypto system still lives on. Nobody since the introduction of this system has been able to solve the problem of recovering the errors or fixing the errors, which is equivalent, from arbitrary words W if you start with GAPO codes and you randomize in this particular fashion. Now, the general concept behind McLeese's crypto system is going to come back on and on over the rest of my lectures. McLeese is really the one who started thinking this way, take some structure that you can invert and add randomness to it, in this case S and P, so that it looks random. Well, it's not really random because if you know how it's constructed, you can do fancy things with it that you couldn't do otherwise. So not only McLeese's crypto system was going to be like this, but several other crypto systems over multivariate polynomials and over lattices will be of the same type. Now, fairly independently of McLeese, Niederreiter introduced another crypto system which at first sight seems somewhat different, but is basically almost exactly the same. Now, one major difference is that Niederreiter proposed to use generalized Reed-Solomon codes as the starting codes that we use here and not the GAPO codes. Somehow, Niederreiter was not as lucky as McLeese because, as it turned out later, this choice was not so good in the end. But everything else is similar. You have a non-singular matrix S, you have a permutation matrix, and you start from your private generalized Reed-Solomon code for a certain parameter distance T, and you hide it using S and P in exactly the same way as in the McLeese crypto system. Now, however, Niederreiter did not intend the message to be in the code word, but on the opposite, the message is hidden in the error vector. Now, there's something slightly annoying about this because error vectors are bit strings of a fixed number of bits. And of course, how do you encode information into error vectors? Well, that's a very old problem, and you can easily establish a correspondence between bit strings. And words of a fixed weight. That's a nice little exercise. You can, of course, these bit strings are going to be shorter than the words because they're just T out of N such strings. So you have here bit strings of length roughly log base 2 of that. But it's a nice little exercise using these combinations to establish a relationship, a one-to-one mapping, which is efficiently codable and decodable. So it's not really a problem that these errors are actually vectors of weight t. You can map bit strings into these. Basically, you need that this t be large enough so that an adversary cannot guess all words of weight t and try them all to see which one fixes the error. So t has to be as large as possible with that constraint. However, if you have a large t, it will make the efficiency of the code to be very low. It will make the dimension. So there's a relation between the dimension and the minimum distance that if one is big, then the other is small, and so on. So if I make a code with very high minimum distance, I'm going to have a very low k, a very low dimension. And if I have a low dimension, then it's going to become possible to enumerate all matrices of this type, and I'll be able to enumerate all the all the code words and try them all. So you can't have neither k nor d too small. So we're hoping for some codes where both d and k are pretty big. But they can be very big, but they can be not too small at the same time. And so in the suggested parameters, we will use values so that we know that enumerating all words of weight t will be difficult. Okay, so in the Niederreiter system, we make the assumption, which is essentially the same as in the McLeese crypto system, which is that recovering the code word nearest to W is a difficult problem if you don't know the structure hidden inside G prime. Now, for both crypto systems, G, S, and P is the private key, and G prime is the public key, and we have errors of a certain weight, and we have the word W, which becomes the ciphertext, which is a code word plus E. Now, for both of them, finding the code word which is nearest to W is easy if you have a correction procedure, an error correction procedure for G. So now let me give you some idea of the parameters that are actually used in practice. In practice, McLeese's crypto system uses codes of length 2048 or 4096, so that we get a high level of security. The plain text size for GAPA codes with 2000, okay, so here are four examples. In the first example, we have a code of 2048 bits long and a minimum and a correctable distance of 32. So the minimum distance would be roughly twice that, so that would be 65. And we have another example with 2048 and design distance 40. We have length 4096, design distance 22, and design distance 45. Now, to get a feeling for how efficient these things can be, the plain text in a GAPA code is almost as big as the length, because it's the dimension that we managed to get for these error levels. So if I have 2048 bit long strings and I have a minimum distance of 65, I can build GAPA codes of dimension 1928 and so on. So in terms of how much information you can encrypt, this is fairly good. This is rather good because it's close. Now, the size of the ciphertext is simply the length of the string, so it's 2048 or 4096. The encryption rate in cycle per plain text byte on an Intel Core 2 increases, but is always in the same range, about 200 cycle per byte. And the decryption rate is something roughly 10 times more. But that's because it uses the Welsh Berlekamp decoding algorithm, which requires a fair amount of time. Now, near-the-writer parameters are fairly similar, except that the plain text size is a lot smaller. Now, the reason why the plain text size is so much smaller is because the plain text is now in the errors. And so how many bits can you encode in error vectors of weight 32? Well, roughly 2 to the 232 such bit strings can be encoded in words of weight 32. And roughly 2 to the 280 strings can be encoded in weight 40 error vectors, and so on. And the last part of this table shows us the sizes of the public keys. So typically, the public key range in the roughly 100 kilobyte, which is a lot more than systems like RSA, for instance. A system like RSA would have something like a few kilobytes. Well, actually, for comparable size, 2048, that's 2048 divided by 8 bytes, so it's a lot less than this. But with current technology, even public keys of this size is quite reasonable. And so this table is estimate of secure parameter size as of 2008. So this is fairly recent, and there's not been any major development in cryptanalyzing these systems, and this is roughly what can be used nowadays. Now, as I mentioned in the in the near-the-writer crypto system, near-the-writer suggested to use generalized Reed Solomon codes. Well, there's been extended studies of what codes could be used for McLeese and Niederreiter's crypto system, and McLeese's proposal to use GAPA codes is the only one so far which has not been broken. So this guy here, Nicolas Sandrier, is one of the researchers who's really specialized. He did his PhD in the late 80s on this topic. He specialized in finding structures in families of codes so that you can recognize which code it came from, even if you have only have the public matrix and not the private information. So he and other people were able to show that if you use generalized Reed-Solomon codes, if you use concatenated codes, if you use elliptic codes, if you use Reed-Muller codes, if you use convolutional codes, if you use low-weight, low-density matrix codes, all these families are bad. If you use them, you can reconstruct the structure without knowing the secret parameters. So this situation is very edgy because for some reason, in 1978, McLeese suggested GAPA codes. But in a way, he was very lucky because to this day, the GAPA codes are pretty much the only family which is not broken. But there is some special structure in the GAPA codes and in the diversity of GAPA codes, which sort of explain why nobody was able to break them yet. But seeing how many of these have been broken is a little bit scary, and it's not clear that GAPA codes will survive. Okay, so one last word. I wanted to say that in code-based cryptography, I showed you about encryption schemes, but there are also signature schemes, one in particular by Courtois, Fagnaz, and Sandrier, where they use code-based, they use codes similarly to do signature scheme. There's an identification scheme by Stern. There's pseudo-random number generator based on codes. And there's also hash functions, which are based on codes. And you can read on all these in standard cryptographic literature. You can learn about all these topics. And you can go into these and find out more. But that will conclude what I wanted to say about code-based cryptography. Yes?
In the table that you presented with the security levels of the codes.
Yes.
That is considering the attack by
Sandrier? Oh, yeah, yeah. This is considering all the known attacks that we have so far. These code-based system based on GAPA codes, they achieved the security level which was described in the table. The table basically tells you, given all the known attacks that we have, the best things that we can do correspond to this kind of security level. So if I go back to the table, the security in bits here is considered the log of the work factor that one needs to work to break the system. So if you work 2 to the 91 steps using some particular algorithm, you can break the system. So 2 to the 91 for this one, 2 to the 98 for that one, 2 to the 93 for this one, and 2 to the 140 for this one. So these values are considered secure by today's standard. By today's standard, we consider that anything above 80 is secure, considering the amount of computing power we can use today, allocating 2 to the 80 cycles to any task is way more than what we can achieve nowadays. 2 to the 50, 60 is reachable, but 2 to the 80 is pretty much unreachable.
Right. So my question, I guess, would be why they share the same level of security if the GAPA codes have not been...
Okay. There's something I should have mentioned here, that of course, because we know that the generalized Reed-Solomon codes are broken, we consider neither writer scheme using GOPO codes as well. Okay, so both of them are implementations using GOPO codes because GOPO codes are the only example that we don't know how to break. So I'm now moving to a second example based on finite fields, which is multivariate polynomials. Now, here's the disclaimer. I know a lot more about codes than I know about multivariate polynomials. So forgive me if my presentation is not quite as complete and accurate about multivariate polynomials and about codes, but I prepared as well as I could, and I hope I can give you a feeling for what is done for multivariate polynomials. Okay, so what are multivariate polynomials? Well, typically, we're working over some field F, which in most of the time is going to be the field of two elements, because working in binary is a lot easier in general. But some systems prefer different choices. A multivariate polynomial is a sequence of polynomials P1, P2 to Pm. So it's a set of m little polynomials, little p, of n variables x1 to xn. And these variables are over a certain field, so you may want to think about it as simply binary strings. So you have m polynomials of n bit strings each, and that constitute a system which has n bit input, m bit output. So the outputs are the zk's, each of these zk's being the evaluation of the small polynomial pk on an input x. And typically, this is a polynomial of degree 2. Why 2? Because we want to keep this degree low in terms so that the computations are not too inefficient. And it turns out that 2 appears to be enough to acquire some level of security. So this is a typical polynomial of degree 2. It's a bunch of coefficients times the xi's, a bunch of coefficients times the xi squares, and a bunch of coefficients times the cross products xi as xj. Now, if we are working in the field of two elements, this is going to simplify slightly because then x squared is x. 0 squared is 0 and 1 squared is 1. So we can get rid of the x squared terms, and we're now down to sums of degree 1, the xi's, and polynomials of degree 2, which are the cross products xi, xj. Now, it turns out that in general, if I give you arbitrary such sequence of polynomials, it's NP hard to find a solution if I give you a Z and I ask you to find an X such that P of X is Z. Then in general, it's NP hard to actually find what X is. Now, for cryptography, we need more than this, or we want more than this. We want that this problem be hard on average, meaning that not only is it in the worst case that you can't find X from Z, but it should be that if I pick random P's and I give you a Z, it should be hard on average to find X so that P of X is Z. And this is what we observe at this point in time in knowledge of computing. We don't know of any efficient algorithm if I give you random polynomials of this type. If I ask you what x is given z, we don't know of any efficient algorithm to solve that. Okay, so typically in the encryption schemes that are based on multivariate polynomials, we're going to take the public key to be a set of polynomial capital P, and the encryption scheme is going to be simply to apply P to a message X. Now, the decryption part, given an output Z, find the X such that P of X is Z, well, that's a hard problem, typically. And so in order to get a decryption algorithm, we're going to need to look at some specific design for the polynomials P, and with special structures, a little bit like in coding theory, for certain families of codes, we have an error correction procedure. Well, for certain families of polynomials, we have an efficient inverting algorithm that will recover X from Z. Now, as a generality, the world of multivariate polynomial is essentially based on the knowledge of a private map Q, which is made public after composing it with affine transforms S and T. So typically, there is Q for which I know an inversion procedure. Q is some second degree polynomial in the Xi's. And I'm going to compose it with an affine transform S and an affine transform T. To be more precise, it means that if I start from X, I'm going to have a linear equation MS X plus CS, to which I will apply Q, to which I'm going to apply another transform MT dat plus CT. And that's the general form how I'm going to hide Q. So in any given scheme, Q is going to be a particular class of quadratic maps, which has an inverse that can be computed easily. And as we will see, this has a long history. I mean, people have started coming up with schemes of this type back in the 1980s. But unlike McLeese, nobody was that lucky, in the sense that everything that's been done in the world of multivariate polynomial has suffered a lot of cryptanalysis redesign, cryptanalysis redesign, and so on. Okay, so once, if we have this kind of transform to hide Q, then we can undo the whole process by using the inverse of the matrices and the related coefficients that are computed from the inverse of the matrices and the initial coefficients. So if initially P is of this form, then the inverse of P is going to be of that form, where, of course, we need somewhere in here, we need the inversion of Q somehow. So in order to use this strategy, we have to define a mapping Q together with its inverse, and then we hide it through the process of composing with these affine transforms. So typically, a private key in such a system is going to be the information of the affine transforms to undo the encryption process, as well as an inversion algorithm for Q. So if P is used for the encryption function, only P is revealed, not the details of what these guys are. Only the resulting final P is made public. And the private key contains all the necessary information so that we can undo the process. And of course, the key ingredient is to have an inversion procedure for Q. So the first proposal along these lines was made by Matsumoto Imai in 1988. And they describe a system which is very reminiscent of the RSA crypto system. Now, I'm sure you've all heard of the RSA crypto system at some point. But let me just remind you that the RSA crypto system takes a message M, raises it to some exponent, mod N, that's the encryption scheme, and the decryption of a ciphertext is take that ciphertext, raise it to some other exponent D, mod N, and raising to the D undoes raising to the E. Now, what is special about the RSA crypto system is that you can make E public, and the information of E is not computationally, doesn't make it computationally easy to find D. Now, the scheme is going to remind us a lot about the RSA crypto system. But as we will see, it's actually much closer to the McLeese crypto system than to the RSA crypto system. But the construction is very similar to the RSA crypto system. Okay, so Matsumoto Imai noticed that if I look at the field of 2 to the n elements, I can define univariate polynomials f over this field. And when I do that, if I look at the representation of this univariate polynomial f over that larger field, I can represent this operation as n multivariate algebraic functions, fi's, over the field of two elements. Now let me write a little bit to explain you what this statement means. If I have the field of 2 to the n elements, then I'm considering tuples of n bits as elements of this larger field. And if I define a function f of these elements, a function like, say, x squared, or x to the 7 plus x 3, I can actually represent this as a function of the bits x1, x2, xn. And the function of the bits is going to be a bunch of little yi's. So if I call the output of this y1 to yn, can you all see this or is the screen hiding? It's fine? Okay. If you name f of the x's to be the yi's, you can rephrase the operation on the larger field as a bunch of operations on the smaller field so that y1 is going to be little f1 of the x's, so that y2 is a little function f2 of the x's and so on. Now, the reason why they do that is because Matsumoto Imai are trying to get to the general paradigm of defining a map of degree 2 between the xi's and the yi's so that they can hide it in the general method that I described. Now, it turns out that if you carefully pick the function that you're going to take as the f of this general principle, if you take q of x, which is over the large field x to the 2 power a plus 1, for a, a number smaller than n, and if it is so that 2 to the a plus 1 is relatively prime with 2 to the n minus 1, then we can represent this function as a quadratic map of the bits and we have an inverse, which is easy to compute. Now, this is where the system is very reminiscent of RSA. You take an X, you raise it to some power, and that power is public. You don't have to hide it, because there are only n values possible. So there's only one of a few set, a small set of possibilities. Now, it has the feature that if this exponent is relatively prime to 2 to the n minus 1, which is the number of non-zero elements in the field, then as in RSA, you can find another exponent h, which is a multiplicative inverse of 2 to the a plus 1 mod 2 to the n minus 1, such that the function q inverse of y is actually raising to the k. So this system is very reminiscent of RSA, because in order to do the encryption, you're going to raise your plain text to some power. And in order to do decryption, you're going to raise the ciphertext to some related power, which is given by this expression. Now, however, unlike RSA, these values are not really secret, because everybody knows 2 to the n minus 1. You can easily try this for all the a's, and so you can find all the k's related to these values. Therefore, the secrecy of this system is not in the exponents. So it looks like RSA, but it's not using the same type of secrecy as RSA, because the secrecy is not in the exponents. The secrecy is in the affine transform that we use to hide the transform Q that we're really using. Now, I want to show you one technical detail here, because I got stuck on it, and I really wanted to clarify that the following makes sense. I claim that computing x to the 2 to the a plus 1 is actually a quadratic transform. And in order to get there, we need to establish that x to the 2 to the a is really a linear transform of x when we consider it as a bit string, as a sequence of x size. Now let me try to argue this. If I have a sequence of x size like this, and I want to square the element in the larger field, if I want to square the element in the larger field, then it should be that I take the polynomial related to this, xn minus 1 times x to the n minus 1, blah, 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 up to x1x plus x0. This is the polynomial associated to this sequence. And I want to square this mod some irreducible polynomial. Now, if I expand this squaring, it will turn out that all the coefficients will vanish, because there will be a factor of 2 involved in these coefficients. And because we're working over a field of 2, the basic field is the field of 2 elements, all those coefficients involving a 2 will just vanish. And we're going to be left with this polynomial, which is just the squaring of the x's. So it turns out that if I square this polynomial over a field, sorry, mod 2, then I end up with the same polynomial, but now the exponents are 2 to the n minus 2, 2 to the n minus 4, down to x2, and so on. And now I claim that this really is a linear transform of the x size. This is a linear transform of the x size because I can construct a matrix, and the columns of this matrix is the polynomial 1 mod p of x, the polynomial x squared mod p of x. Now, for all the low degrees, 1 mod p of x is 1. X squared mod p of x is x squared. But when I get above n, then these are fairly complicated vectors, but they are constant. So the columns are the powers the even powers of x mod the p of x. And this defines a matrix so that if I multiply this matrix by the x size, it will exactly do the same calculation as I'm trying to do here. So basically what this is showing is that the operation of squaring on the elements in the big field is actually a linear transform of the bits of the small field. So there exists a matrix that I can call M squaring, which is so that if you multiply this matrix by X, it squares the value of X. So it means that the operation of squaring is just a linear transform, so it's a degree one operation. And if I want to raise to the 2 to the I or 2 to the A, the only thing I need to do is to raise this matrix to the power I, and that will do exponentiation 2 to the I times applied to X. And now I can break this down and say that the YIs individually are each one a linear transform of the XIs. It's the submatrix of this MSQI and in its first row, in row 0, in row 1, in row 2, in row n minus 1, and the multiplications give you each of these YIs. So raising to the 2 to the I is a degree one system of equations for the YIs from the XIs. Now, if you want to compute X to the 2 to the I plus 1, then it's essentially like computing the YIs that I just described and multiplying them with the XIs. And if you expand this mod P for P in irreducible polynomial, you will see that you only get the cross terms and you end up with a system which is a system of equation of degree 2. So let me borrow a few words from Eddie Shamir. So I found a whole presentation by Shamir, and this is some of his words. So Eddie Shamir is one of the inventors of RSA. So he was very, how can I say? He was very biased to RSA, of course. But this comes from a talk where they showed that the Matsumoto Imai system not only is broken, but some extensions of it are also broken. Okay, so as I said earlier, unlike the RSA scheme, the size 2 to the n minus 1 of the multiplicative group is known to everybody, and so computing the inverse exponent to 2 to the a plus 1 is actually easy. And so the only secrecy of such a system is based on the general scheme where you involve the two affine functions, one on the inputs and one on the output. And this is what makes your system apparently secure. Now, without any further details, I tell you that in 1995, Jacques Patarin broke the Matsumoto Imai scheme completely. He found some low-degree relation between the input and outputs. And what makes the system work is also what makes the system fail. So the same reasons why the system give you a nice inverse, and you have computations that are all quite reasonable, is also the essence why the system failed. And so after breaking the system, and based on an idea of Shamir, Patarin and colleagues redefined a new system based on Matsumoto Imai that they called S-flash. Now, S-flash uses a similar public key to what is used in Matsumoto Imai, but a number of equations are removed. Now, if you remove some equations, it means in particular that the public key will not give you all the yi's anymore. You don't, not the public key, but if I compute some yi's, which is the output of f of some xi's, I'm gonna miss some of these values, and therefore the process is no longer one-to-one, because I'm gonna have many solutions that may yield different sets of complete yi's if I complete them with arbitrary values. So the resulting scheme was called Flash and was fairly popular for a while. So if we denote the final truncation using pi, then the Flash system embeds a Q, which has an inverse that we're trying to hide. It has an S and a T, affine transforms to hide Q, and then there's truncation to get rid of some of the equations that we had. Now, such truncated systems are good for signatures, meaning that we don't mind too much when we use this as signatures that we don't have all the coefficients. But for encryption, it's very annoying because we no longer have unique decryption. And so this system essentially evolved from an encryption scheme to a signature scheme, and the S in S-Flash is for signature. Now, S-Flash was selected in 2003 by the New European Schemes for Signature Integrity and Encryption Consortium. This is a standard consortium which establishes standards for common everyday applications of cryptography. And they recommended three systems, one of which was S-Flash. And it was considered at the time to be the best known solution for low-cost smart cards. So S-Flash became very popular around 2007. And unfortunately, the very first version of S-Flash, called S-Flash V1, had a subtle bug in it that was discovered by Gilbert and Minier. And then it was rapidly replaced by S-Flash version 2 and version 3, which are essentially the same but with different parameter set. So let me tell you what these parameters, remind you what they are. So Q is the larger field. So we're working over a field of 2 to the 7 elements. N is the number of equations, and yes, n is the number of equations. A is the exponent to which we are raising. We're raising to the power 2 to the a plus 1. And r is the number of equations which are dropped in the S-flash mechanism. Now, unfortunately or fortunately, this is where these slides were taken from. Dubois, Fuchs, Shamir, and Stern in 2007 broke S-flash of version 2 and 3 and broke any hope that S-flash will be extended. Now, let me give you a few general notions regarding multivariate polynomial schemes. Multivariate polynomial schemes, as I said, have been approached for a first time. It was broken. A number of extensions were invented. Many of them were broken. Some of them were not. It has a number of possibilities. Okay, so the variations that you have here allow for some plus operation where extra polynomials are added to the central map, minus operation where you remove some of the public polynomials. You hide internal perturbation, adding randomness to the system. you fix some variables to zero, you add vinegar, adding extra variables that can be set arbitrarily, and you can make single field central map, which is sparse, which speeds up in general. Now, I feel biased in the sense that I think in general that this multivariate polynomial direction is very interesting, but unfortunately, every single scheme that's been around has never lasted very long. This is most likely unfortunate fate due to particular choices, but everything so far in this area has been pretty much broken within a few years, and so it's very hard to assess which of these schemes are likely to be secure 5 or 10 years from now, because many of them have been broken. So let me give you a similar table to what I showed you for code-based encryption. If we compare RSA with a 1024-bit modulus, we can compare that in terms of security with a elliptic curve crypto system, which is very much linked to Waterloo and the people in the math department here. These elliptic curve crypto systems were put forward, and their big advantage is they have much smaller key size than what is used, for instance, with RSA. And then these four systems are different variations of multivariate public key crypto systems. PMI plus stands for perturb Matsumoto IMAI plus, with this set of parameters. Rainbow are a completely different type of multivariate polynomials, where the central map is completely different from the Matsumoto IMAI. And quartz is yet another system. I'm not going to tell you that much about it, but essentially, one reason to show interest into these systems is that they are fairly reasonable in terms of secret key size, public key, and the performance computing the public key map is a lot faster than what we get for systems like RSA and elliptic curves, and except for quartz, which is extremely slow in the secret map computation, but everything else is a lot faster than RSA, for instance. And that concludes what I wanted to tell you about multivariate polynomials and their applications in cryptography. Now, of course, let me remind you that the main reason why I discuss these different possibilities is because, again, multivariate polynomials don't appear to have any faster solution on a quantum computer than what we have on a classical computer. So all the systems that we have been describing don't seem to be weaker if we have quantum computers. I wanted for this section to discuss an advanced topic. This is supposed to be an advanced course, and I'm doing pretty much introductory material, except that I want to discuss a little bit the notion of cryptographic money, which is based on hidden codes, and this nicely connects multivariate polynomials and codes in a cryptographic application of building quantum money. Now, I won't have time to tell you everything about it today. I'll probably finish tomorrow. But let me at least introduce you to the problem and give you an idea of what we're trying to do here. Now, the idea of making unforgeable money goes back to the invention of quantum cryptography. When quantum cryptography was invented, one of the very first applications by Wiesner was the idea that you can use quantum states to make banknotes that cannot be copied. And the general scheme of Wiesner was, if you put a bunch of qubits that you know exactly their value, if you put that on a banknote, once the banknote gets back to you years later, you can look from the serial number, look at what the states are supposed to be, measure all of them individually according to what you know they should be, and if they all look right, then probably this is your banknote. And it's very improbable that anybody is able to start from one banknote and make more than one because of the no-cloning theorem. Now, what is attempted in this work, and it's very interesting work, is to make quantum money, which has the feature that it can be verified publicly. So if I have, in the Wiesner scheme that I describe, you need to know precisely what the banknote is to verify it. And so you cannot tell that to everybody, because if you tell that to everybody, everybody can make banknotes. So you have to keep that information secret, and only the bank can verify that it's valid. Now, in this scheme here, what they're trying to do is to make it so that you can publicize public information so that everybody can check the banknote, but nobody is able to duplicate it. Now, it uses some nice relation between codes and multivariate polynomial over finite fields. If you start with a code C, let's say an NKD linear code over a field F, and you have a positive integer degree D, let me define IDC to be the set of degree D polynomials that vanish on C. So that means I define some polynomials over a finite field F and multiple variables that are the coefficients of a code word. And if the polynomial on these values is zero, then that polynomial vanishes for that code word, and if it vanishes for all the code words, then that polynomial vanishes on C. Okay, so this is what it means here for a degree D polynomial to vanish on C. And for simplicity, we assume that the basic field is a field of two elements, and so we consider code words that are binary of a binary code. Now I need two statements to use this. One is that it's possible to sample uniformly random elements from this IDC in time, which is n to the d. So if I take a fixed degree like 2, 3, 4, 5, I can sample uniformly from the polynomials that vanish on C in polynomial time. Now, of course, the smaller d, the faster. But as we will see, we need d to be somewhat not too small. And the second lemma that they use is the following, that if I choose beta n independent uniform samples from this IDC. So let me remind you again, this IDC is the set of polynomials that vanish on C. It doesn't vanish exactly on C, but it vanishes on at least on C. Now, if I take many such polynomials with very high probability, if I take at least beta n where beta is more than 1, then with probability essentially 1, 1 minus exponentially small, the set of points which are the zeros of all these polynomials is exactly C. Okay, so if I take sufficiently many of these polynomials together, they define exactly C. Each one of them individually defines more than C, but the intersection of all these is exactly C. So Scott Aronson and Cristiano came up with this scheme. Consider that you have a certain code C, which is spanned by some generating matrix, and consider a bunch of polynomials that all vanish on C. Well, pick a set of such polynomials and make that public. And similarly, consider C perp to be the dual of the code spanned by G, which is the kernel of G. And for that too, establish a bunch of Qs, polynomials, beta n of them, so that they uniquely define C perp. Now, what is wonderful about this particular system is that if I give you these polynomials, the PIs, and if I give you the QIs, they uniquely define what C and C perp are. But computationally, it's difficult to find out exactly what is C or C perp from these polynomials. If I pick random code words, if I pick random words and I try to see if they vanish, if they satisfy that all of these are zero, well, it's very unlikely to happen. So if my code has a sufficiently large dimension and the dual has a sufficiently large dimension, then the probability that I pick random x's and that they vanish for all these polynomials at the same time is negligible. Which means that if I'm trying to reconstruct what C is and what C perp is, at least it will not work if I try to guess elements from it, from C or from C perp. Because if I pick random elements, they will essentially never be from C and never be from C perp. Now, what is believed is that we do not have any efficient algorithm. If the degree of these polynomials is high enough, we don't have any efficient algorithms to actually tell anything, or more or less, about C and C perp. So, of course, we know that the all zero code word is part of C and part of C perp, but that's about the only information that we have about these two dual codes. Okay, so for all the words in C, the polynomials PI yield zero, and for all the words in C perp, the polynomials QQJs give you zero. Now, quantum money, as constructed by these guys, is as follows. I'm going to make a banknote to be a dollar ket state, which is the equal superposition, I left out the coefficients because it's all equal, an equal superposition of all the code words of C. Now, what is remarkable about this state is that all the elements of the superposition satisfy that it's in C. And in particular, if I apply the PIs to these values and I compute quantumly what the outcome is, I'm going to get zero for all of them. And if any of them is not from C, I'm going to start getting some values which are discordant with everything else, and they're not zeros. Now, the remarkable feature of C and C perp is so that if you apply Hadamard to each of the qubits, well, that should be here in Hadamard power q, power n, applied to the qubits of my quantum money, then it will transform the superposition of all the code words in C to a superposition of all the code words C prime from C perp. And this is a very remarkable property which is only achieved when you get all the code words here. If I have all the code words and I apply this transform, I'm going to get all the code words from the dual. But if I have just one code word here, say, and I apply the Hadamard, then I'm going to get a lot of garbage here, which are not code words from the dual. So the only state which goes back and forth between these two possibilities is exactly the superposition of all the code words and the superposition of all the code words of the dual. So these two states have the exact property that they map back and forth between each other if you apply the Hadamard transform of them. So you can start with this, you can apply the Hadamard, go here, you can reapply the Hadamard, go back here, and so on. So these two states can be exchanged for each other. So the idea of these people is that if you have such a state, well, first of all, you can check that it's valid. If you know the PIs and the QIs, you can check that it's valid because you take that state. You don't know what the codes are, but you've been given the state. So I have this state in my hand. I can apply the polynomials to this superposition and figure out that this superposition is such that if I measure the output of all those polynomials on all these this superposition, I'm going to get zeros everywhere. And once I've done that, because they were all in this, they were all zeros, I will not have affected the state at all. Because if it is the superposition of all the code words, then measuring that they were solutions of the polynomials is no surprise. They were meant to be. And so doing the validation that the polynomials all agree that this is zero for this state is not changing the state at all. So now I can apply the Hadamard and move into the dual. And now I can do the same trick with the dual. I use the QIs and I check that this is a superposition of states of the dual. And I can do that again without affecting the state, because if it's a superposition of states in the dual, applying the QIs will all yield zero. And I knew that ahead of time, so it's not actually affecting them at all. Now, of course, it's not a proof of security that I claim that this is apparently secure, but we have found no way at all that you can construct any states which is slightly different from this that will satisfy these two tests at once. Every possible strategy and every possible quantum strategy that's been adapted to this has either been impossible because of the no-cloning theorem or because it would break the assumption that you cannot recover C and C perp from the PIs and the QIs. Now, there's no formal proof that for every attack you do, you must either break the assumption that you cannot tell what C and C perp are, or you're breaking the non-cloning theorem, but every attempt that's been done is of this flavor so far. Now let me just say a few last words about this. If I take these polynomials with these properties, it turns out that the particular structure of C and C perps yields an attack if the degree of the polynomials are only two. So if the polynomials, the PIs and the QIs, are only of degree two, the fact that C and C perp are dual essentially yields to an attack. So therefore, the degree must be at least three. Now, if I have quantum money with C or C perp, I can sample one element of C or one element of C perp. So if I look literally at the quantum money, I will see a code word from C, or if I go to the dual, I will see a word from the dual. So when I have a banknote, I can always sample one element at the cost of destroying the state. But if I could, from one element, reconstruct the whole code, then I would be able to make more money. But it's actually known that if you have degree three polynomials and one sample, it's actually equivalent No. Let me say this again. If you have degree 4 with one sample, it's actually equivalent to degree 3 without samples. So if you are in a situation where you may be able to sample, then you must go to degree 4 to get security equivalent to degree 3 and no sample. So for this reason, the authors chose D equal 4. This is the lowest exponent that they were able to use for security. And as far as we can tell, for degree 4 polynomials, all the nice properties that I told you kick in. You cannot tell what C and C perp are from polynomials of degree 4. And breaking the scheme in any way so far has been equivalent to either breaking the no cloning or breaking the fact that these don't yield information about C and C perp.